That was Reverend Robert Lee IV at the VMAs in August. But when he returned to his parish in North Carolina, his call for unity and healing was met with a bit of a backlash that made him walk away from that pulpit. He's here today to share his story. Welcome, Reverend.
Thank you so much.
Welcome. So, you're the great, 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 great nephew of Confederate General Robert E. Lee. You're born and raised in the South. Why'd you decide to speak out against these Confederate monuments?
Well, after Charlottesville, my heart was broken. I had the opportunity to meet Susan Breaux when I was at the MTV VMAs, and it was one of those things that with her losing her daughter, I had to say something.
Yeah.
Because if you're silent, in these issues, you become complicit in these issues.
Mm-hmm.
And complicity is not something I stand for.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's right. So you speak out, and what you say goes viral, and a week later you're resigning as pastor of your church. So what happened?
Well, I can't speak for the church. I can only speak for myself. But what I do know is that it's hard to stand for something. My great grandmother would always tell me, if you don't stand for something, you'll fall for anything.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I had to stand up and say, this is what I believe in, and I'm going to stand by it.
Uh-huh. Well, we tried to. Yeah. We tried to reach out to your church for a statement, but we've had no luck getting a hold of them. I'm really confused here, though. I don't understand how the church, which is, you know, a beacon of compassion, could reject you when you stood up for what I would say they should be applauding you for.
Well, it's supposed to be a beacon of compassion.
Well, I'm naive because I just assumed that's what you'd find in a church. The idea that they rejected you when you came back, I don't understand.
Well, yeah. Look, I resigned because of it, but I do know something that's true about the church. White Christianity is having trouble dealing with what's going on in our nation today. We're having trouble talking about these issues of race, of reconciliation, of reparations, of redemption, and we have trouble finding the vocabulary to speak about these issues. But I want it to be said of me that there was a Lee in history who stood up for something that was right, instead of a General Lee who stood up for something that was wrong.
Well, Reverend, After Charlottesville, you gave a sermon and you said this: if you are silent at a moment like this, if you do not condemn the racism you see through whatever channels and avenues you have, you can leave church now because you're doing church wrong. Are you saying that those who want to keep politics out of the pulpit are doing church wrong?
Well, I'd say that the pulpit is inherently political. I look to the black church tradition, and I see in that tradition that the AME church, I had an opportunity to preach at Heard AME Church in New Jersey yesterday, mm-hmm. and we all agreed that politics is part of the pulpit, because for so long the black churches had to deal with politics through the pulpit.
Right.
So I see this as a way of combating racism and white privilege and white supremacy in the best way that I know how, through my pulpit.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I want to get back to these monuments, because it's such a debate right now about the potential removal of these monuments. And the argument that I hear from many people who are against it is it's a slippery slope. And they say, you know, 10 of our first 12 presidents were slave owners. And I hear both sides in that respect. I'm very sensitive about the issue of the monuments, but what happens if people start calling for everything to be removed? Are you worried about where this could lead in terms of removal of aspects of our history that were just plain part of our history, good or bad?
Well, you mentioned the slippery slope. I think we're already on the slippery slope, right? I mean, if we're engaging in building monuments, and if we realize the context of the monuments, mm-hmm. that were built before 1950 and as a sign of white supremacy, I think if you contextualize the monuments, then it's important to realize those monuments have to have more context, more understanding, because that's the slippery slope that we'll be on if we don't address this soon.
But the other thing that this keeps coming up, this conversation that you just brought up, it seems to me that Robert E. Lee and those Confederate guys were traitors to the Union. Mm-hmm. So that's treasonous behavior. It's not the same as George Washington. Mm-hmm. So you're not going to put Benedict Arnold's statue out there
exactly.
either. So that's the real point of it, isn't it?
Yeah. And I think also one of the things that you have to remember is if you look in Europe, you don't have statues to the fascists.
No, they do not.
You have the memorial of what happened there.
Right.
In terms of your name in particular, though, there are more than 100 historical markers with your great uncle's name. There are Robert E. Lee schools, parks, bridges. In your opinion, should they all come down, or should the name be removed off of all of those things?
I do, because I think about it this way. My white child may not have trouble going to that school, but a black child might.
Yeah.
And these schools that we're talking about are disproportionately in persons of color communities, and that's concerning to me. Like, what would it mean for me to go to a school with the persons whose name my ancestors may have been owned by?
Right.
You know, that speaks a lot about what right. we're saying as a nation right now.
But it's an honor. It's an honor given. So why are you honoring these people?
Yeah. Do you feel the same way about the Confederate flag? Does that include the Confederate flag?
Well, I must confess that, you know, growing up, I even had a Confederate flag in my room growing up, because I was proud of Robert E. Lee. I was proud of the history that we had, and that it took people calling out my privilege as a white person, as a white cisgender male, and saying, you have to confront your own privilege. And I looked to my confirmation mentor, Bertha Hamilton, who told me, you know, as a person of color, you have to accept and love everybody and engage in your privilege. And she did that so well that it made me take the flag down. And so that's, for me, it's a personal endeavor to take those flags and those monuments and those school names off of what matters.
When I think sometimes as a young kid, you take something in not quite grasping the context of what it symbolized.
Right. That's fine.
So innocently you fall in line thinking, oh, this is...
It's cool, right?
It's cool.
Yeah. But my parents and my confirmation mentors and my church back home always taught me that we have to treat people with respect and with dignity. And if we can't do that, then we're not being church at all.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
I almost could go back to church just to hear you talk. I mean, this is what it's supposed to
church
sound
right.
like. This is
what
you need
to keep talking.
To
he does church
you
right.
You can never stop talking.
Well, we have
you
to shift
never.
The narrative, right?
Yes.
We have to say that there's a different way of doing church that is not what we once thought it was. You've got all kinds of people in the news who are supposedly church leaders. Well, let's get some church leaders in the news who are doing Christianity right.
Right. That I'm a Catholic, I'm a Christian, and Christianity has somehow become a bad word.
I think it's become a bad word because we've done it to ourselves, right? You know, we hear Steve Bannon talking about stuff like that, about illegal aliens, and people are people. They're not illegal, right? You know, that's the thing we have to remember. We have to engage in this conversation in such a way that we're saying, this is not the church that I know. I know a Jesus who is liberating and offering us hope.
You know what? You can come back here anytime. You can come back anytime.
Okay.
We thank you for coming today. Thanks to Reverend Robert Lee IV. We will be right back.